Femoral shaft fractures. The femur is the longest and strongest tubular bone in the human body and one of the principal load-bearing bones in the lower extremity. The femoral shaft can be divided into three parts. The proximal portion, including the femoral head and neck and the intertrochanteric area. The majority of femur fractures occur in the proximal third, hip fractures, which are discussed separately. The middle portion involving the femoral shaft and the distal portion, including the supracondylar area. In this video I discuss the midshaft fractures of the femur. Femoral shaft fractures are high-energy injuries to the femur that may be associated with life-threatening injuries. Femur fractures can cause extensive hemorrhage, with blood loss of up to 3 liters and an average loss of 1 liter. Complications and injuries associated with midshaft femur fractures in the adult can be life-threatening and may include internal organ injury, fat embolism, pulmonary embolism, and acute respiratory distress syndrome, ARDS. Fractures of the femoral shaft often result from high-energy forces such as motor vehicle collisions or falls from height. In older adults, low-energy falls are the most common cause due to osteoporosis, especially in elderly women. Long-term use of bisphosphonates may increase the risk of rare type of thigh fracture. This injury, known as atypical femoral fracture, is similar to a stress fracture. Industrial accidents and gunshot wounds account for most other femur fractures. Pathologic midshaft femur fractures are uncommon but can occur from bone cysts, metastasis or, rarely, secondary to primary bone tumors such as osteogenic sarcoma. A femoral shaft fracture usually causes immediate, severe pain. The patient will not be able to put weight on the injured leg, and it may look deformed, shorter than the other leg and no longer straight. The clinical diagnosis is usually obvious based upon the mechanism and the presence of pain, swelling, and deformity, including shortening of the thigh. Extensive soft tissue injury and bleeding are common and shock may develop. Because of the high association of femur fractures with other injuries, particularly if high-energy trauma is involved, the patient must be carefully assessed following the basic guidelines of Advanced Trauma Life Support, ATLS. Stabilization of the patient's airway, breathing, and circulation takes priority. Once the patient is stabilized, a thorough secondary survey is performed looking for other major injuries. As part of the secondary survey, the pelvic ring, hip and knee should be inspected. Neurovascular injury caused directly by a femoral shaft fracture is rare. Nevertheless, a careful neurovascular assessment of the affected limb should be performed. Distal pulses should be palpated, and sensation and motor function assessed. It is often useful to compare findings to the contralateral limb, assuming it is uninjured. Anterior, posterior, and lateral plane radiographs of the thigh should be obtained when a femur fracture is suspected. Careful radiographic examination in at least 2 planes is necessary to determine the exact site and configuration of the fracture pattern. The hip and knee should also be examined with radiographs to rule out associated injury. A femoral neck fracture may occur in association with a midshaft femur fracture, and if overlooked, can result in significant morbidity and even mortality. The management. Pre-hospital personnel should splint the extremity in the position it was found. Essential initial management at the hospital consists of evaluating the patient for major injuries and treating them as appropriate. Placing an intravenous catheter and providing analgesia. Patients with open fractures receive antibiotics and tetanus prophylaxis. For the time between initial emergency care and your surgery, your doctor may place your leg either in a long leg splint or in traction. Skin traction splints can be used for both closed and open fractures of the femoral shaft. Hare or Thomas traction splints are most commonly used. It keeps the broken pieces of bone together and often helps to relieve pain. The device is attached to the ankle at one end and secured against the pelvis at the other. Traction is applied by pulling the ankle distally while the proximal end braces the pelvis to prevent it from moving, thereby enabling distraction of the femoral fracture fragments. The art of femoral fracture care involves a balancing act between anatomic alignment and early functional rehabilitation of the limb, so that the surgery is indicated for the large majority of femur fractures, regardless of its location or degree of displacement, because of the high rate of union, low rate of complications, and the advantage of early fracture stabilization, which decreases morbidity and mortality. We recommend that femoral shaft fractures in polytrauma patients be repaired within 2 to 12 hours of injury, provided the patient is hemodynamically stable. Performing operative fracture repair within the first 24 hours decreases mortality, respiratory complications, multisystem organ failure, and length of hospitalization. Early surgical repair may be less important in patients with isolated femoral shaft fractures. Nevertheless, we advocate early repair. Currently, the method most surgeons use for treating femoral shaft fractures is intramedullary nailing. During this procedure, a specially designed metal rod is inserted into the canal of the femur at the hip. The rod passes across the fracture to keep it in position. A retrograde intramedullary nail can be inserted into the canal at the knee in case of ipsilateral femoral neck fracture, ipsilateral tibial shaft fracture, also called floating knee, to use the same incision for tibial nail. Ipsilateral acetabular fracture, so it does not compromise surgical approach to acetabulum. Bilateral femur fractures to avoid repositioning. Morbid obesity to avoid difficult avantigrade start point with obesity. Pregnancy, especially first trimester, for low radiation exposure to uterus. Intramedullary nailing provides strong stable fixation. Intramedullary nailing is associated with a 98-99% union rate and low risk of infection, even when used in open fractures. Plates and screws are often used when intramedullary nailing may not be possible. During this operation, the bone fragments are first repositioned into their normal alignment. They are held together with screws and metal plates attached to the outer surface of the bone. This method is inferior when compared to intramedullary nailing, due to increased rates of infection and non-union. In cases where there is severe injury to the muscles, nerves or arteries, or there is significant contamination with dirt, rocks or grass from the injury, some patients require external fixation prior to definitive surgical treatment. External fixation may be used in unstable polytrauma to ensure the patient is physiologically optimized prior to definitive fixation. This is an operation, metal pins are placed into the bone above and below the fracture site through small cuts. The pins are attached to a bar outside the skin to stabilize the fracture and hold the bones in the proper position. After secondary operations to clean the wound or recovery of skin injuries, or if the patient is physiologically optimized, the external fixator can be removed, and plates and intramedullary nails or plates and screws can be placed. In some cases, an external fixator is left on until the femur is fully healed, but this is not common. Recovery after surgery. Postoperative activity depends upon the adequacy of internal fixation. If fixation is solid, an agile cooperative patient can be out of bed within a few days of surgery and ambulating on crutches with toe-touch weight bearing on the affected side. follow-up patient visits with the orthopedic surgeon to monitor fracture healing with radiographs are generally performed at approximately 2 weeks, 6 weeks, 3 months, 6 months, and 1 year post-injury. Most femoral shaft fractures take 3 to 6 months to completely heal. Some take even longer, especially if the fracture was open or broken into several pieces, or if the patient uses tobacco products, or if he is diabetic. Cutting down or quitting smoking and tight blood sugar control is important for the healing process. Physical therapy will help to restore normal muscle strength, joint motion, and flexibility. It can also help you manage your pain after surgery. Most patients need about 3 to 4 months of therapy to regain their pre-injury range of motion and strength. Patients usually have good ambulation within 1 month and can expect to return to normal activity within 3 to 6 months in younger patients and up to 12 months in elderly patients. Athletes may safely return to sports when the femur is completely healed and normal strength and range of motion are regained. Most athletes return to pre-injury levels of function after approximately 9 to 12 months or longer, depending upon the complexity of the injury. The intramedullary nail usually stays in for life and are not routinely removed. However, if the metal becomes infected or is painful 1 year after surgery, it can be removed. Complications. The most common complications following femur fracture include infection. Factors associated with an increased risk of postoperative infection include open fractures and comminuted fractures treated with open reduction. Malunion. Femur heals at an abnormal angle. Malunion of clinical significance is uncommon. However, rotational malalignment may occur with comminuted fractures. The hip, knee, and ankle joints compensate a great deal for many minor malunions. If the patient is symptomatic, surgical correction may be needed. Delayed union. There is no sign of healing at 3 months. Non-union. There is no sign of healing at 6 months. The most important factors associated with the development of a non-union: the damage to the local soft tissues, tobacco use, delayed weight bearing, patient non-compliance, and diabetes. The pain associated with orthopedic hardware. Pain emanating from an orthopedic implant can be a difficult problem to identify. Hardware removal frequently is performed with successful results but may not always lead to resolution of all symptoms. Heterotopic ossification. It is rarely clinically significant.